So in 2008, there was a secret found footage movie released to the public about a monster attacking Manhattan. In 2016, we got a follow-up that took place in a completely different timeline about aliens invading Earth, John Goodman being a creeper, and Mary Elizabeth Winstead being as gorgeous as she was in Sky High. Now we got a third installment that, like 10 Cloverfield Lane, was originally its own thing. And this one was originally a movie just called God Particle. But JJ is kind of like Drake in where he just finds standalone little things, little stories, takes them to add his own little spin to it, and rewrites a little bit of a Cloverfield connection in there to kind of just add it to the franchise. So it's kind of like those Super Bowl tight ads and where every movie is secretly becoming a Cloverfield film. Now, my twin is a huge fangirl on this franchise, and he has a channel where he's going to be covering all of the deep connections, the ARG, the themes of the movie, all that good stuff over there, but here, I'm going to serve it to you straight for those who just saw it on Netflix and are confused, because while everyone's freaking out about the release and how genius it is that it's coming out on Netflix on the same day it's announced, I think it was kind of like their plan B since, you know, maybe they thought it was too confusing or not good enough for theaters, so, you know, they were just going to give it a stream it. Let me explain. See, we get introduced to this Earth where they're like an inch away from getting into this all-out war since the entire planet is running out of power. I would have suggested just collecting children's screams like Monsters, Inc., but they decided the best thing to do is to send space people into space and have them run a particle accelerator to generate power for the people back home. Because I guess solar power isn't a thing. The crew is made up of different countries, so obviously there's going to be some beef between the Russians and the Germans since they don't trust each other. There's a conspiracy back home by people who think that they're just using the particle accelerator for other things. And then there's this 3D Easy Bake Bagel thing that at least everyone can agree is garbage. We get a clip of an author who wrote the title of the movie into a book, and he pretty much breaks down everything you need to know. Using the particle accelerator is going to open up different dimensions. It's going to unleash monsters, it's going to alter things in the past, and it's going to screw up different timelines. We know this because the dude talking is Howard Stambler's brother from 10 Cloverfield Lane. And not only is that crazy, but this chick right here who's doing the interview is the same woman who came in pounding at their door in 10 Cloverfield Lane. These two just so happen to be different versions from a different timeline. So simply put, when they boot up the particle accelerator in this movie, it releases chaos upon every dimension possible. So that first Cloverfield movie, it's its own thing, but the monster is kind of caused due to the events in this movie. 10 Cloverfield Lane, it's its own thing, but Paradox is what kind of sends the aliens their way. Paradox itself technically introduces two dimensions, two little timelines, and they themselves created their own monsters. Think of it like this. It's an anthology series, and there's like a writer who's written all these different stories and kind of wants to connect them together, but also doesn't want inconsistencies, so, you know, they just put them all in different timelines, and they just say that this movie, Paradox, is what causes it all. Like I said, it's like a Tide commercial. You can now make any monster movie a Cloverfield movie. But now that we get the connections, what the heck is this movie about? Well, when they boot up that God particle, they think that they pulled a season 5 of Lost and caused the Earth to just disappear, not realizing that they're actually in an alternate reality. And this is where things get trippy. If our main peeps right here are known as World A, they've now come into World B, and due to equilibrium and things wanting to go back into order to stop chaos, they start meshing with each other. Think of it like Coco or any other afterlife time travel movie where the character starts disappearing unless they start, you know, correcting things or they go back to where they belong. That's kind of what's happening here, just in a more jacked up way. They find Mina Jensen, who is the commander of Ship B, within the walls of Ship A due to both worlds combining. The Russian dude ends up getting meshed with the worms they were experimenting on, as well as that gyrosphere map that they needed. Since Ship B crashes into the water, because I guess it wasn't manned since their whole crew got raptured, we then see parts of Ship A get filled with water, and it ends up killing a character. Ship A's foosball table starts changing colors so it can be the exact same colors that Ship B's would have been. Ship A starts receiving intel that Ship B would have had, and probably the craziest one of them all is when characters start getting combined with their alternate versions, like Mundy, who right before the incident has no bandages on his arm, but then magically appears with them because it wouldn't be Mundy A's hand, but dun dun dun, Mundy B's hand. That's why later on, when the chaos starts ensuing and things try to get balanced, his arm gets sucked up into the wall, cut off, and even though arms wouldn't really have sentience, since this is from Mundy 2, it goes all Adam's Family and gives them the info that they need to know to get back home. Embarrassingly enough, turns out Earth never disappeared. They were just upside down. Because these guys are Earth's finest. Of course, they realize it's not World A that they're looking at now, but World B. And Mina, who is from World B, informs them that they're actually in an all-out war down there because things have gotten so bad due to not having energy. I found that interesting because throughout the entire movie, she's trying to convince Ava 1.0 that in this world, her kids aren't dead due to, you know, her fire-inducing electrical mistake that killed them, but that they're living happily ever after in World B. Even though World B is in an all-out war. After seeing a majority of the crew die throughout the movie, we see Mina go ballistic because she obviously wants to stay in her own timeline. They Sparta kick her out of the ship, boot up the accelerator again, and the final survivors make it back to their dimension. Also, throughout the entire thing, we follow Ava's husband back on Earth 1, who's clearly not in 2008 considering the technology and the cars. So while there is a monster attack going on, and even though it kind of looks like the same monster we know and love, remember that Cloverfield 1 takes place in a different timeline. It's its own thing. Trust me, my twin will make a more in-depth video about it, but like I said, this movie itself kind of told you that everything's happening in alternate timelines. His story pretty much revolves around him hearing about a monster attack, trying to figure out what's going on. He finds a little girl whose screams generate power, like I said. And then he goes to a bunker, a different bunker, and gets upset right at the end of the movie when his wife and the Shepherd Station finally come back and are given orders to return to Earth, even though it's getting demolished by... And boy, is that thing 10 times bigger than the first Cloverfield monster. Thank you guys for checking out this video. Like I said, by the end, you would assume that they all just die since they go back to a place that's getting demolished by monsters. But for those of you who are still kind of confused, to give you the too long didn't watch, it pretty much goes like this. This movie is the paradox story. It just creates different timelines. There's a connection, but they're not really, you know, going on at the same time. They're all just different movies. So kind of think of it, all these Cloverfield movies, as a huge monster anthology, right? It's like Black Mirror, but with creatures. And the main connection is that this movie is kind of what sparks it all off, as they're all in different timelines. Confusing, I know, but as long as you enjoy the movies in and of themselves, then that's the best part. And then just looking at the Easter eggs, which, like I said, my twin will make a video on. But as far as this one, let me know your thoughts on this movie, if you liked it, if you hated it, what you thought was the best part of it. And remember to comment, like, and subscribe, and I will send you your own slusho drink so you too can turn into Clovey.